Hello, gentlemen. We're coming to session three, which is what does a godly man look like? And I'm not proposing by swinging the camera to me that I necessarily look exactly like that, but I will be sharing with you some things that I've learned through the years. It's a very important question, especially for church leaders, but it was addressed very in-depth in the Bible, where Paul was speaking to Timothy and to Titus. And these were young men that, as he was beginning to see the end of his life, he shared with them the things that were most important in trying to pick men who could really carry the gospel. And folks, I'll be very straight with you again that that's actually what we're doing right now. With this workshop, with the plans of workshops in the future, we're looking for men who can carry the gospel, trustworthy men, reliable men. And that's exactly what Timothy and Titus were instructed to do by Paul. And so I want to share with you that I found a great resource for the issue of A Measure of a Man, and actually it's a book by Gene Getz. And I've shared this with Dr. Kenneth, and I gave him a few copies, and we'll certainly work toward getting more. But this is a lifetime work of a really incredible man of God, and it's kind of a landmark book of men's ministry, certainly in the United States, but I believe around the world. And I want to use scriptures again, because that's really the only thing we can really rely on. But let me read just a couple of scriptures, and then I want to share with you Gene Getz's summary of the scriptures about regarding the traits or attributes of a godly man. But from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says to Timothy, "The things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." So this thing of the gospel, and as it spread around the globe in the 2,000 years since Christ, that's been the key thing, is to find faithful men who you can entrust with carrying the gospel, because the gospel is a precious gift. And in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, Paul again is talking to Timothy, and he says, "It is a trustworthy statement. If any man aspires to the office of overseer, it is a fine work he desires to do." Many of you may think you would really like to be a pastor, or you'd like to help people come to know Jesus. If you've experienced the fullness of Christ and the love of Christ and the joy that comes from all of that, it's natural to want to share it. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing right now, because I have seen the power of the transforming power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And so he goes on about the husband of one wife, and temperate and prudent, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not addicted to wine, gentle, peaceable, free from love of money. He must be one who manages his household well, keeping his children under control. And that's really, by the way, talking about pretty much that's the way you raise them. Once they're grown, they have to be on their own. But if a man does not know how to manage his own household, how will he take care of the church of God? And he advises Timothy not to use new converts because they might become conceited. So he's looking for more mature men. And don't let that discourage you if you're a brand new believer. Just walk the walk, talk the talk, love people, serve God, and then you will grow to be mature. And he must have a good reputation with those outside of the church. Interesting. Because it's not just about in the church. It's the whole world that we're really... And so that man wouldn't fall into reproach or the snare of the devil. And then to Titus, and by the way, Titus was ministering on an island, and it was a very difficult ministry, and Paul had ministered there, and so he was sharing the word with Titus, and he says, "For this reason I left you in Crete," that's the island, "that you would set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you." So if we think about the regions of Uganda and we think about each city, if we follow these directions, we'll be appointing an elder or a person who is mature in Christ for each city. Namely, if a man is above reproach, the husband of one wife, having children who believe, not accused of dissipation or rebellion, for the overseer must be above reproach as God's steward, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to wine, not pugnacious, not fond of sordid gain, but hospitable, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word which is in accordance with the teaching, so that he will be able to exhort in sound doctrine and refute those who contradict. So, for there are many rebellious men, empty talkers and deceivers. So what Paul is acknowledging is exactly what we see in our world today. There are many people who really don't understand God's directions and God's appointment for men and the role that we have. And so we have to be able to live a life so that we're able to confront and acknowledge the problems and address them. So those are the scriptures, but there's a lot more scriptures throughout the Bible that Gene Getz pulls together, but primarily he refers to those. Now, in doing that, and this book is 20 attributes of a godly man, and he addresses each one of them in great detail with the scriptural references. And if we had time, I would propose we do some studies of particular chapters, and maybe you could do that in your work groups if Dr. Kenneth proposes and outlines a plan. That's great. I'd support that fully. But the 20 attributes that Paul Getz or Gene Getz developed is overall spiritual maturity. That's number one. In other words, a well-rounded man. Overall spiritual maturity. And he talks a bit, and you guys could study that in that chapter. Number two, he needs to be above reproach. He's got a good reputation. If you ask people around town or you ask his family, they'll speak positively of him and recognize him as a good man. Now, the third one gets some controversy in the United States and probably anywhere, but the husband of one wife. The Bible's real clear about multiple wives, but there's also the issue of divorces and separations and problems like that. But the main thing that I think Paul is addressing here is moral purity. Because the sexual sins, that's a sin against the temple of the Holy Spirit, our own bodies. And so that's what he's addressing. He must be temperate. That's balanced in words and actions. The man must think about what he's going to say and then plan his actions accordingly. He must be prudent, and words for that, and that's a word that I don't use a whole lot, but we're really talking about wise and humble. Now, I don't know what you're thinking about right now, but as I think of these, and I think about the first two steps that we talked about of becoming a godly man in session one, about really accepting Jesus and seeking to be like Jesus. And then I think about the Holy Spirit's guidance. I start thinking about, I don't have a chance of doing these things unless I have Jesus as my Lord and Savior and the Holy Spirit as my counselor. So we can go right down the list, but and I'll go quickly now, because I think in your study groups, or perhaps in work sessions that Dr. Kenneth will outline, you can work on particular ones of these, and maybe pick one or two or three or four that you want to dig in depth, and get a hold of a book and see what they say, and look at the Bible. Because remember, the Bible is God's Word. It's His instruction book to us. And everything that we need in our lives is there. So it's a matter for us to dig for it and to ask the Holy Spirit to help us. He's our counselor. He's our guide. He's our ever-present help. And so we just need to call out to Him. But I talked about prudent, respectable, hospitable, able to teach. That's a real big one. That's an important one. Not addicted to wine. Not self-willed. Not quick-tempered. See, you can spot right away if a man's, in my case, my neck might get red or my ears might get red. And anger is not necessarily a bad thing, but the words here are void of, in other words, you don't have anger that becomes sinful. So anger that can cause sin is the kind of anger that he's talking about here. Not pugnacious, that means he's not prone to fight. Given a confrontational situation, he'll seek a peaceful resolve to it. Not compromising the Word of God and truth, but not wanting to seek out a fight. He's gentle, peaceable, free from the love of money. Now, that's a really big thing, because the Bible talks about money perhaps more than any other single topic in the Bible. And love of money is about materialism. It's wanting things versus serving God or loving people. And so that's why he talks about that. Manages his own household well, as a husband and father. He loves what is good, and he pursues godly activities. There's a lot of activities that we can pursue in our lives that are not really godly. He's just, he's devout, and he's self-controlled or disciplined. So that's quite a long list. I tell you, I would be absolutely frightened to death if I had to try to do this on my own. But I don't, because of the very reasons of the things we talked about earlier. We have Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior. We have the Holy Spirit as our helper and our counselor and guide. And we have the Father that we can call on as well in prayer and seek Him. Now, a very healthy activity to do, and you could do it now if Dr. Kenneth so directs. You could list all 20 of those traits, and you could evaluate yourself as a score of how you feel like you do with those traits. And if you're really courageous, and I'm not sure I'm that courageous, but if you're really courageous, you'd ask your wife or your family to evaluate you in those areas. Now, why would you do that? Well, for me, as a man who I have to know what I'm trying to accomplish. I have to know where I'm doing well and where I'm not doing well. I served over 40 years in industry as an engineer, working in a number of different jobs and with a lot of different responsibilities, sometimes quite large. And I always had things that were to be accomplished, and there were goals, and I was measured as to how well I was doing them. And if I wanted to get better, I had to listen very carefully. Or if I wanted to be promoted, or perhaps given more responsibility and thereby perhaps more money or more of a sense of accomplishment. If I was going to do that, I had to know where I was doing well and where I was not doing well. Well, these traits or attributes of a godly man are, they're measurable. We know whether we have these or not. And what we don't know, the Holy Spirit will help us with. And our wives or our families will let us know. So I just tell you that unless we measure or unless we look at our lives, there's a quote I sometimes use, an unexamined life is a worthless life. In other words, we need to look at it, honestly reflect on it, and think about how we're doing. Well, this is an absolutely great list. If your goal is to become a godly man, and I pray and hope that every one of you do have that goal, that you would be a man who would reflect Jesus Christ in his actions and in the things he does. If you want to be that kind of man, you need help. Now, in addition to, say, a guidebook like this, which is great, there's another thing, and I'm going to talk about it in the next session, and that's your brothers, one another, and in your small groups, you can be honest with one another, and you can, as you build and grow in your faith, you can find out who are those trustworthy men, the men that you can talk with and have rules that say, look, what we share here stays here. So recognize that the men in this, the very room you're sitting in, maybe some of those who can help you on your journey to become a godly man. So I just want to close with prayer. I want to thank you for your attention, and I want to ask the Lord to bless you in sharing in your groups what this means to you. Do you know what a godly man looks like? If you met him on the street, or you worked with him, or you saw him in the field, would you know that was a godly man? And I contend that you would, because the attributes of Jesus and the attributes of a man who loves Jesus are those that we talked about. And you'll see the fruit, because you don't have to know what kind of tree it is. You see the fruit. So, Lord, I just thank you for this time. I thank you for the men here. I ask you to bless them now as they share and as they learn and as they grow. And, Lord, may it all be used to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.